This is a strange and lonely playroom. We hear no prattling voices, and the toys go untouched. Two boys, Peter and Marty, play alone. Time has stopped for these children because they are victims of a severe emotional disorder called autism. Institute at the University of California in Los Angeles, where researchers are studying the nature of autism. A major symptom is the autistic's withdrawal from the human world. People are objects he stares at blankly. He feels no need to communicate, so he rarely learns how to speak. He lives in a world of his own making. Marty's symptoms are extreme. Alone, he plays bizarre, ritualistic games by the hour, seeking to satisfy his constant craving for stimulation. Peter is less autistic than Marty. His concentrated interest in the pencil sharpener represents a higher level of development than Marty's simple game with a stick. Marty's autistic love of repetition, however, shows up in Peter too as he grinds down pencil after pencil. Peter has been doing this for weeks, ignoring all other playroom activities. Peter's mechanical skill is actually superior to that of many normal children. It shows that unlike the mentally retarded child, he can often think and act effectively. Researchers hope that autistic children can be taught other normal skills, such as speech. Learning to speak is essential in the treatment of autism. Experience shows that if five-year-olds like Peter and Marty do not learn now, they may not be able to learn at all. Dr. Frank Hewitt, who does research at the Institute, leads Marty into a teaching booth, a device for teaching him speech. Before he begins, the teacher must establish control over his pupil. To do this, he uses a variety of rewards and punishments to evoke simple responses.
So in this teaching booth, we can provide both pleasant, rewarding experiences for the child, as well as somewhat unpleasant experiences. For instance, when the child is cooperating and performing as the teacher directs, he may be given a piece of candy from this candy window. And should the child fail to cooperate, fail to pay attention while the teacher is working with him, he may be given a negative reinforcement, such as having the booth closed off and being separated from the teacher until he initiates contact by pushing a button on his side of the booth. Hi, Marty. Marty,
touch my ear.
Good boy. Marty,
touch my ear.
First step in getting control over Marty was inducing him to imitate simple gestures on demand, like clapping his hands.
Marty!
Clap your hands. Clap your hands.
Marty!
Clap your hands.
Clap your hands.
Marty!
Clap your hands. Marty!
Clap your hands.
Marty!
Clap your hands.
Marty! Good boy.
Dr. Hewitt rewarded him with candy only if he responded with the correct imitations.
Marty!
Marty.
The candy encouraged Marty to repeat the gestures whenever he was cued.
Touch my ear. Touch my ear. Touch my ear. Come on. Marty, touch my ear. Come on. Marty, touch my ear. Marty, touch my ear.
Good boy.
Marty, touch your nose. Marty, touch your nose. Marty, touch your nose. Good boy. Marty, touch your nose. Touch your nose. Touch your nose. Touch your nose. Thank you. You don't like that candy.
It took 2 months to teach Marty these responses, but this was the first time his behavior had ever been effectively controlled. The next big step was to start him on the road to speech. Dr. Hewitt worked on one intelligible sound that Marty made spontaneously.
B-B-B. B-B-B. Marty.
By repeating the sound and offering him a candy reward, he hoped to train Marty to imitate him. He could then try to shape Marty's sound into a real word, but it did not work. If Marty would not vocalize for candy, would he speak up to avoid a punishment, like turning out the lights?
B-B-B. B-B-B.
Good boy.
B-B-B. B-B-B. B-B-B-B. B-B-B. 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 B-B-B.
Good.
Finally, the candy worked too. Marty had taken a step toward acquiring speech.
Good boy.
Got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, let's make the 6 again. You make it 6. Yeah, you make it. Make 6.
Peter has come much further than Marty.
6.
His teacher, Miss Ethel Rabb, has taught him to draw, to write the alphabet and numbers up to 50. Yet until he entered the teaching booth, Peter, like Marty, had never spoken an intelligible word.
Hi, Pete. Hi. In the chair. In the chair, Pete.
Oh. Hi.
Peter was a quicker pupil than Marty in every way. He quickly understood about imitating Dr. Hewitt and responded to a variety of rewards besides candy, like this cartoon movie.
That's right. See the movie. Good boy. Good boy.
Okay, touch my face. Touch my face, Pete. No.
Put your finger in the air and leave it about a year. Put your finger in the air, in the air.
Yes, you're hearing music. No, don't touch that, Pete. No, we don't want to touch that.
Put your finger on your hand.
He was soon ready for the next step, learning to say his first word.
Good.
Dr. Hewitt chose a simple but highly meaningful verb, go.
Go!
Go!
Remember that, don't you, huh?
Go!
Go!
Peter soon got to put his first word to good use.
Go!
He learned he could use it to get a spin in the chair.
Okay, Pete, in the chair.
Go!
Round and round, Peter goes. Round and round, Peter goes. He goes all around.
Go.
Round and round he goes. Good boy. Okay, C.
She.
He learned other basic words.
She.
C.
She.
Good boy. Good boy.
What's this?
Wow.
I?
Huh? Wow.
Good boy. Good boy. Peter? In the chair. What's that?
Nah.
Come here. Look at me.
Nah.
What is it?
Nah.
No.
Nah.
Good boy. What's that, Peter?
Ear.
Touch your ear.
Ear.
You touch your ear.
Ear.
Touch your ear.
Ear. Ear.
Ear. Good boy. Sit in the chair, Peter. How are you?
Fine.
How are you?
Fine.
What's your name?
Banana.
Peter.
Peter.
What's your name?
Banana.
Peter.
Peter.
What's your name, Peter?
Peter.
Hardest for Peter was learning replies to simple questions. This required more understanding than imitating the teacher on cue.
How are you?
Fine.
How are you?
Fine.
What's your name? What's your name?
Five.
What's your name?
Five.
What's your name?
Five.
What's your name, Peter?
Peter.
What's your name?
Five.
What's your name? Peter.
Peter.
Peter. What's your name, Peter?
Peter.
What's your name?
Sandy. Peter.
Good boy, Peter. What's your name? Peter.
Peter.
What's your name, Peter?
Peter.
What's your name?
Peter.
Good boy. Good boy. Okay. What's that, Peter?
Mom, Daddy.
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 Sit down, Peter.
Dada.
Sit down. Sit down.
Dad.
Who's that?
Mama.
Who's that?
Mama.
Huh? What's this, Peter?
Toilet.
Toilet.
Dad.
Good boy. What's this?
Food.
Food. What's this?
Water.
What's this? What's this, Peter?
Peter must learn to use his hard-won words in his daily life. Dr. Hewitt encourages this by making him say the words to get things he wants, like water to get a drink.
Come on. Let's go on here.
At first, this treatment was frustrating. Now he is used to everyone making him say his words.
What is it?
D.
Key.
D.
Key.
D.
What's that? Toilet? Toilet. Now, Peter's learned about 15 words, and we've taught them to him.
Dr. Hewitt has invited Peter's family for an important visit. He wants Peter to use his new words with them because soon they will have to take over the job of teaching him themselves.
And that you would never give him water unless he would say water. He actually says, I want water. This is the way he puts it.
How strict shall we be in the fact that he must say the words distinctly instead of I want water, I want water?
Well, to begin with, the important thing is that he makes an effort to say the word in the situation. Yeah. And very gradually we can, I think, begin to hold him for a better quality reproduction. But at first, that isn't too important. The important thing is that Peter has gotten the idea that people communicate with words and that words pay off, that words will get you things you want. Mm-hmm. Right. And that is the most important thing we've done. Come here, Peter, I want you to sit down. You let me, maybe I can try a few things. Sit down, Peter. Peter.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Fine.
How are you?
Fine.
Good boy.
Dr. Hewitt prepares the parents to work with Peter directly. A two-way mirror allows the camera to film the scene without distracting Peter.
Who's that?
Daddy.
Hey.
Hewitt turns the session over to the parents. He does not know how things will go between them and Peter, but he hopes for the best. The completion of Peter's education depends on this transfer from teacher to parent.
Peter. Peter. Hi. How are you?
Fine.
That's a good boy.
What is this, Peter? Sit down.
Food.
Yes.
That's right.
And what is this?
Toilet.
Who's this?
Peter.
Good. Oh, yes. And who's this?
Waffle.
That is water. Now, Peter, come back here. Come back here. Sit down. Peter.
Sit down, honey.
Peter. Sit down. Don't play in the water. Sit down. Sit down.
All right.
My.
Put it right. Put it right.
You should defend it.
That's a B7. Sit down.
What picture would you like?
Mama.
Okay.
Mama. Here's Mama.
Daddy.
Daddy. Let me find Daddy. Where is Daddy?
Peter.
Where is Daddy?
Peter.
Where is Daddy?
Peter.
Who's this?
Peter.
No, say it right. Say Daddy.
Daddy.
That's a good boy. Oh.
What picture would you like next, Peter?
Peter.
Peter? Okay. Peter. Let me find Peter. Here's Peter.
Food.
The long sessions in the teaching booth have produced good results. While the causes of autism remain a mystery, Dr. Hewitt and his colleagues at the Neuropsychiatric Institute are now hopeful that children like Peter and Marty can be helped to conquer the tragic effects of autism.
Very well, honey.
What we've seen in the case of Peter is the beginning of the most important aspect of our speech program. His parents were able to get him to use this experimentally acquired speech with them, and hopefully we'll be able to continue to reinforce this when they're with him, away from the hospital, on home visits. In the case of Marty, we've just made a bare beginning, and there's a great deal more basic work to be done. It's hoped that continuing research in the field of developing communication skills in autistic children will enable us to more effectively teach speech to children like Marty and Peter, and to initiate this kind of procedure long before their fifth birthday.
Good boy.